I'm delighted to welcome up on stage two SEMS master's students to conduct this part, which is all about the future. So please put your hands together for Carlo and Adriana. Carlo Alberto Frassettini and Adriana Fometti. Carlo and Adriano are also the co-founders, I believe, of the Nova SPE Politics Club. So you're in the perfect position to interview now, live on stage, the President of the European Parliament, Roberta Metsola, who I'd now like to welcome to the stage. Roberta Metsola, European Parliament President. Welcome to Estoril. A very busy lady. We're so happy to see you here.
Nice to see you again.
You can take a seat.
Hi, nice to see you.
Good to see you.
Hi.
Hello. Hi.
So good afternoon, everyone. Hi. Dear Honorable President Metsola, thank you so much for being here on stage with us today. Also, dear Honorable authorities, guests, professors, dear colleagues and friends, thank you for staying with us until this moment. It's amazing to see our business school filled with this amazing audience. So thank you, Daniel Trasa, our dean, for making this happen. And thank you to the Estoril Conferences team, Silvia, Carla, Ines, for giving us this opportunity and for building this. Thank you. So, Madam President,
Roberta.
We are the Purpose Generation. And as the Purpose Generation, we aim at building the future of hope. And so we try to get inspiration from people like you that have been already working in building this future of hope. However, our home, Europe, nowadays, has been facing a time of challenges, unprecedented time of challenges, with pandemics, conflicts, and energy crisis. Which is why we would like to ask you a few questions to better understand how we, as the Purpose Generation, can act to make this home, Europe, safer in the world ahead. So my first question would be, how is it for you to be part of the current dialogues with and on Russia on the energy securitization and on the Ukrainian conflict and invasion? And what do you think the short and long-term solutions to this conflict, to mitigate this conflict, could be?
And also, would you envision an actual entrance of Ukraine within the EU in the close future? And do you think this would then accelerate and promote the integration of further countries within the European Union framework?
Okay, so first of all, thank you very much for having me here. Thank you for using the word purpose. I think that growing up, my generation was usually talking about a future, where we could be when we grew up. But you're using the word purpose because what you're doing actually means something today. And that is the reason why I wanted to come here. That is the reason why when I got elected in January, before any of these challenges, or at least the extent of the challenges that you've just mentioned, became so apparent, I thought that the only way that an institution such as the one that I form part of and I have the responsibility and privilege to lead needs to meet people like you, meet colleagues like yours, friends like yours, who really want to change or try to see how they could change. On the 24th of February, Russia invaded Ukraine. I would never have thought that my generation would have to witness war on our continent. I thought that all that was behind us. But a few days into the invasion, I started to meet my colleagues from countries that are geographically closer to Russia. And I realized that for the last decade, whenever the question was brought up, there is a concern, there is a threat, we are overly dependent, we take things for granted. Peace and freedom should never be taken for granted. We looked away. So we lost a lot of time, which we are now trying to catch up. I think, and this is ironic to say it, but the COVID pandemic, with all the challenges it brought, And I would have thought that this year was going to be based on economic rebuilding and stability and the resilience that we hoped to be equipped for. What it did equip us is with an understanding that Europe matters. That whereas for years we thought Europe has nothing to do with health, let national member states deal with it, individual countries, no competence, why throw money at that? But the minute we entered a pandemic where borders physically were reconstructed against a virus that crossed them, and we needed to find not only financial solutions for economies that came to a complete halt, but also we needed to provide a medical solution, not only for our continent as leaders of that, but also for the rest of the world. And that realization that where you want to do something, you don't use, as a lawyer I can say this, legal obstacles not to do it, but you actually give the political answer to what our citizens want. Today, I would use that experience in order to try to address the challenges we have today. We're not dealing with one crisis, we're dealing with many of them. And we're trying to deal with all of them at the same time. We have a war challenge. A country has invaded another, threatening the very fundamentals of territorial integrity, sovereignty, freedom, and peace. We have ever-rising costs that started already before, that came with an increase in demand, but also because resources are more scarce. We also have an environmental crisis. And my first concern, I think it was about mid-March, was that our instinct would be to say, look, all our ambitions, all our targets that we've been pushing for against huge challenges, with huge challenges, that are the only means for us to become competitively advantaged, when compared to other continents, we need to achieve. My concern was that the immediate instinct would be to pause, that we need to ignore the targets or push them back. That has not been the case. The European Parliament and the government have realized that we are required to address all these existential questions that we are being faced, perhaps with a slight nuance that we really need to realize that different countries have different realities, whether geographical, whether economic. Some countries are much further ahead than others, but some countries need that extra push in order to get there. So I would think that that's what we need to address in the meantime. We took the decision, courageous decision, unprecedented decision, to open the door to Ukraine, and Moldova and Georgia. I come from a country that joined in 2004, and I have experienced myself the transformative effect that Europe has had on my country and on the other 9 countries that joined on the same day. And my message, which I will expand on when I give the closing comments, is that we need to make sure that when a population, when people on our continent, in countries that look to Europe as their home, let's make sure that their door is open for them. Because otherwise, it is in too many autocratic countries to shut that firmly.
Thank you so much. Now I would ask you, how do you feel as a European in the new world order with the current geopolitical shifts and events? So where does the European Union stand? And also, how can we together as the Purpose Generation address the challenge of a common foreign and security policy in order to build a safer world ahead for us? And also, how actually close are we to the NATO? And how do you think, what do you think is the ideal balance between our historical Atlantic alliance towards the United States and versus new opportunities as well towards the East?
I have never been prouder to be European than I am now. We have challenges. I don't see the EU and NATO as being in a position or even the need for there to be competition, but rather complementarity. Back to where there is a will, these things happen, would never have imagined that Finland and Sweden would already be on the cusp of joining the alliance. This is also domestic discussion for me. My husband is Finnish. And when my first son was born in 2007, and there is obligatory military service that still applies in Finland, my husband told me, do you know what? When our son, when Luca, who's now 15, will be 18, there will no longer be obligatory military service necessary. Look at the world today. Security is more important than ever. You were discussing in the previous panel about bans and movement, etc. We need to make sure our citizens are secure. We had forgotten this as well. It was 5-6 years ago, that was the top of our agenda. We need to also understand the migration challenges that we will continue to be faced with. At the same time, and this is where I said I'm proud to be European, and I lead an institution where majorities have been found that I never thought possible would be found in a very, very difficult political scenario, but that where the values that bring us together, even though there will be always players that want to break them, to ignore them, to simply hide behind different guises of misinformation or actual interference in democratic processes. But what brings us together is that we have the tools to address that. Have we always succeeded? No. Is it very difficult to enter the European Union and then so easy to forget all the rules that you signed up to once you're in? Yes. Have we had our failures? Yes. Has it sometimes taken us 10 years to adopt a fundamental social piece of legislation that has an immediate impact for the most vulnerable part of society? Do we still have too much of a gap between what women and men earn? Of course. But my answer to that is more Europe rather than less. My answer to that is let's go back to basics and make sure that people believe in politics again. In 2024, the European Parliament will have its next round of elections. These are fixed, so they can't move. Helpful. But we have a target, we have an aim, 2024. This country had a very low, a high abstention rate in 2019. We need to increase that. It has become far too easy for the gap between disenchantment and engagement to grow. Not everybody's like you or me. I was like this when I was your age, excited about everything. But the excitement needs to be transformed into real, what you meant, purpose. And when you actually are in the world, in wherever you are, in whatever country, you need to make sure that change is the ultimate aim. And I think we have the tools, we have the manpower, we have the resources, we just have to use them better.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. I just have one last question for you before leaving you the stage. I was wondering what, in your opinion, is the role of Europe and the European Parliament on cross-actor cooperation? We are in a university, we have institutions, we have companies and civil society. And how does this relate to nowadays challenges? And also, how can we talking to you right now, the people in the audience, the purpose generation, actually prepare to rethink those interactions create better synergies?
Yeah, I think, and I was given an introduction of this institution, this organization when I came in, and the idea of modeling the way we educate to what is needed is far too recent. We have been living in societies, and this is where, when you mentioned our role in a global society, we have fallen behind when compared to other continents in targeting what our society needs and tailor-making what we teach and what we learn. And this in a time where truth and non-truths travel at the speed of light. This is at a time when the old, the traditional way of receiving the news and understanding the challenges, the sources of which you are not aware of sometimes, where children don't read anymore, where punctuation is gone because you're writing on, you're texting again, and this is a domestic, a private, a personal experience I have. My children don't write SMSs, text messages to me anymore because I correct the language when I send it back and I say I will not answer until you write it correctly. But speed of light, at the same time, our younger generations are not having the time to think and analyze and able to address the challenges. So where what you do, what you study, make sure it is applied. Make sure it is not forgotten. And make sure that you encourage your friends to discuss more, to be able to discuss more, and challenge the stereotypes. And don't just take what politicians tell you for granted and think it's always correct. It's not always correct.
Thank you.
Thank you.
That brings this conversation to an end. Thank you so much there to Carlo, and thank you so much, Adriana. Great questions.
Thank you.
And of course, great answers there from Roberta Metsola, the President of the European Parliament, who also reminded us about those important elections taking place in Europe in 2024. Roberta Metsola, I would like to leave you on stage. You can take to the podium if you like for the final speech, the keynote speech of the ESTEREL Conferences 2022. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, caros amigos. Thank you for having me here today in beautiful Portugal as the world gets closer to 200 days of war in Europe. As we close off intense discussions at this ESTEREL gathering, I've been asked to speak to you about the world ahead. I wonder if someone talking about the topic in 1945 would ever have imagined that in 2022, so many would have forgotten the consequences of nationalism, of populism, of right, of might. Or someone giving a speech in 1960 would ever have imagined that while we all connect instantly through our mobile phones, so many are more lonely than ever before, and that so much of our politics is more fragmented than ever before. That all the knowledge of the world would be accessible at our fingerprints online, and yet so many seem oblivious to the lessons of history. The 24-hour constant stream of news, Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook would make many less impacted, less caring, not more. That fake news or disinformation would literally travel the world at the speed of light. I wonder if someone addressing a crowd in 1990, after the fall of the wall, would have imagined that the foundations of the liberal democracy that ended decades of fear, of lost generations of oppression, would ever be called into question again. Or that despite all the warnings, the world would keep overheating, that our rivers would start to evaporate and our forests combust. Or that women would still earn less than men. Or that while we are the wealthiest society in history, the gap between those who have and those who have not remains too wide. Or that tanks would roll across European borders again. Now, I paint a picture that on the face of it seems bleak, but it's not. It is my attempt at a clarion call for change, a catalyst to activism. I've seen so much in the past 2 days I've been here, to shake up our role in society. And it is my appeal to all of you to find your voice and speak out. The world ahead is one that only we can create together. Destiny is never predetermined, it is forged. The project that we call the European Union was created to answer the issues our people faced. It was our so-called future-proof way of ensuring that the world would remain focused on striving for justice, equality of opportunity, and real democracy. It took enormous courage to dream of a European Union, but it took much more to make it real. It was the dreamers who did that, who created this bastion of rights and circle of trust, of economic openness and pluralism. And dear friends, despite the challenges, I look forward with hope, with optimism, with purpose. Because it is true that we must face down nationalism and populism. But it is also true that we have millions of young Europeans who are engaged, who do speak out. That for every pseudo-strong man on the rise, we have people who look at politics as a positive force for change. For every autocrat threatening our neighbors, we have a unity that has survived the pressure. That we may, and we do still have, a pay gap between women and men. That women's rights are still under threat, but that we are passing legislation to address it. That more people than ever are being pulled out of poverty and hopelessness. That while discrimination still exists, our LGBTI community is less worried. We still have a way to go, but racism is less prevalent. That we continue to fight climate change and pandemics, but we share firefighters, ventilators, vaccines, and doctors across borders. We will be the first carbon neutral continent in our lifetime, and that is the power of Europe. That, friends, is progress, even if it is not always fast enough, not always deep enough. It is steps forward. It is Europe, and that is what Europe has done and what must continue to do. But Europe will only survive if we fight for it, if we stop taking it for granted, if we explain, once we understand them, all its benefits, if we listen, if we push back against those who are determined to undermine it, if we are able to reform and not be afraid to do so, if we are able to reinvent our project. That's what the European Parliament's call for a convention on the future of Europe is all about. It is about ensuring that we continue to the conversation to leave Europe fit for the next generation. There can be no sacred cows, no untouchable third rail. We cannot risk falling behind because our bureaucracy is too cumbersome to change or allow narrow interests to take precedence. Imagine the last major reform took place a generation ago. And we know that what once worked for EU15 is at its limit for EU27. So this will not be able to work for EU32 or EU36. It is time. Now, Europe is not about creating everyone in the same likeness, but it is the core belief that everyone, in all our diversity, have the same chance. Friends, above anything else, Europe is about hope. Hope in the future and hope in the next generation. A bright spark, a beacon of light. When we look to our east and see Putin's tanks, or China having risen with a value set very different to ours, when we look to our north and see what Brexit has done, or to our west and see the deep societal divisions that Trumpism has exploited, when we look inwards and see principles that we took for granted now being called into question, that is when the world needs Europe at its best. We need that hope. We need the values that Europe stands for. And I want people to recapture the sense of urgency, of optimism in the potential of our project, because kicking reforms down the line is not an option. To me, Europe always represented opportunity, change, possibility. When 10 countries joined in 2004, including my own, this was the culmination of years of progress, of massive societal shift. It meant everything. It transformed Europe, and it gave a future to millions. And that was not easy. It took belief, it took courage, and we need to find that courage now again when we look to Ukraine, to Moldova, to the Western Balkans, to Georgia. Europe has the power to transform, but we have to find the political bravery to take that leap forward, to change the world. And we can do that. We should do that. Because if we do not write the future, it will be written by those with a very different narrative and have a very different ending. The world that we know has changed dramatically. The axis tilted on February 24th with the brutal, unjustified, and illegal invasion of sovereign Ukraine. I am proud of Europe's response. We have stood with Ukraine. We have given military aid, political and diplomatic support. We have welcomed millions fleeing. We have provided funding on an unprecedented scale. We have shown that we care. And arguably, the most significant political move was made to grant Ukraine EU candidate status. Because Ukraine needs hope, and Ukraine is fighting for Europe, and we will not turn away, no matter how long it takes. Their values are what Europe stands for. It is those values that we must protect, and we must get better at explaining why these values are essential, why there can be nothing without them, why it is worth the cost. Too often we talk about democracy, equality, the rule of law, as if they are lofty concepts that belong in theoretical, dusty library books. We need to demonstrate every day why they are needed and how they can make a difference to people's lives. I mentioned earlier that we have the knowledge of the world at our fingertips, but technology also means that we are facing an onslaught of disinformation wrapped up in a peculiar type of populism, where cynicism is encouraged and easy answers are floated as false solutions to difficult problems, where the other is dangled as the cause of all frustration and woes, where nationalists peddle fake nostalgia about a glorious past that never really existed, where you are pigeonholed into black or white boxes, even if reality is a thousand shades of gray. It's not easy to push back, but since when has this been a criterion for action? We cannot talk about the world ahead without examining the world today. Right now, people are worried about their bills, about getting to the end of the month, about the world that they will leave for their children. They worry about the future, and Europe must be able to respond. When people feel that democracy does not help to address their loneliness, their isolation, and frustration, people will be driven away from it. Economics matter. Jobs matter. Dignity and education matter. Because if the extent of the economic gaps in society mean that too many people feel alone and alienated, that is when they will feel that Europe has failed them. Heating our homes, fueling our industries, and driving our cars is becoming more and more difficult. Inflation is keeping prices high. We know this. But when we go weary and tired of the conflict, that is when we will need to stand up and stand firm like never before. That is when theoretical Europe must be met with practical leadership, with commitment and courage. And Europe must rise to meet that challenge, whether it is tackling the cost of living, electricity prices, climate change, defense, food security. The only way forward is if we are united. And there are decisions that we can take now that cannot wait. We can act together to limit the impact, whether it is capping of bills, fixing our pricing systems, or decoupling the price of electricity from gas. These are things that we can do now, even temporarily, to offset the immediate pressure while we implement longer-term strategies. Because if there was a moment for more Europe, it is here and it is now. Dear friends, Europe is a choice. A choice that countries made because they understood that our chance is best if we are together. We chose Europe. So despite the many challenges and hard truths, I am optimistic. I am full of hope. I am confident in the possibilities of our time. And when I look at our young people across Europe, I know that the future is bright. And I am convinced that because of Europe, the world ahead will be better, has to be better than the one we leave behind. Muito obrigada.